Well, good afternoon and welcome to yet another edition of the New Old Show here on 91.3 KSVY-FM Sonoma. I am your host, James Marshall Berry. And we missed last week. I remember I had promised I had five straight weeks of live shows. And then we failed last week. And that wasn't because, it wasn't because of me, I don't think, but probably was. The guest was ill, and he could not make it. And he was driving all the way from Alameda. So we certainly didn't want to put that on them. And so anyway, we are live today in the studio. And, of course, what we do here is we preview, we get to know people who are local musicians here in Napa, Sonoma, Petaluma Valleys, but also people that are coming to town. And these cats are coming to town this weekend as part of the Music in Place series that's happening at Sonoma Plaza. Music in Place, of course, putting on 16 shows this year, I think, in their series. They're going to have even more next year, I believe. And these are members of the Alpha Rhythm Kings, and I have on my right Rob Dehlinger, right? And someone who I've just met, Vernon, what is your last name?
Black.
Vernon Black, go ahead and pull that mic up just a little bit. There you go. That's about fine.
Vernon Black.
There you go.
People call me Vernon Ice Black, but my mama calls me Vernon. Boy, you better get in here and clean that up.
Yeah.
Vernon Ice Black, yeah.
Yeah. She ain't never called me Ice, bro.
So the Alpha Rhythm Kings, we're going to talk a little bit about the band, but we're going to hear a little bit about we're going to learn a little bit about both of you all first. And this is kind of something I like to do because the stories aren't always the same. I mean, sometimes they're similar. Sometimes there's a couple events that ring true with a number of people. But it kind of depends on what age you are and where you were. Now, I'm thinking with you guys, it isn't going to be either one of these. But was there a time, like Rob, is there a time when you were younger or you were somewhere and something happened or you saw something and that was the time, the day you realized, I need to be a musician. Was there a defining moment like that for you?
Yeah, actually, I can think of the main one. Actually, and I was about 12 years old.
Uh-huh.
And it was the first time I played in seventh grade at the first jazz band concert.
And you were already a musician, or?
It was my, second year of playing the trumpet, because that's uh-huh. I started when I was 11.
So it was classes, and then you gigged.
Public school band, and we had our concert.
Uh-huh.
And as soon as I played that trumpet solo, it was on Tuxedo Junction.
There you go.
The Glenn Miller. But I just went, you know what? Because it just came out, I was nervous. I didn't eat dinner. For years, I didn't eat before concert.
I still can't because I sing, and I don't want any. And then there's always, I ate, and now I'm sick. And that's halfway through the third set, and it ain't good. But, yeah, no, I agree. So you played.
So I played, and as soon as that night was over, I thought, just the natural high of doing that, I thought I could do this, and I kind of never changed my mind after that. But of course, as all musicians, you have ups and downs and times where you're gigging a lot, times where you're not, and all that. But
so were you you've been a full-time musician your entire life then?
Pretty much. But as I look at it, I've also been an educator a lot in my adult life, whether uh-huh. part-time or full-time. I actually fell into teaching full-time almost by accident, straight out of college, and I did that for about 6 years, and then it's been kind of back and forth, and I find that a lot of artists are teachers, whether privately or whatever, so I finally am embracing that part of me, because the selfish part of the artist wants to be able to say, I just live on my art, and I don't have a day job, and now I'm fully embracing the fact that, no, I love teaching as well, and, letting kids learn.
Teaching music.
Right.
So music has been your bread and butter.
Always music, yeah.
Wow, and that's great. That's great to be able to say that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I had a great teacher in high school. He was the choir director and the assistant band director, and he gave me advice that I took. He said, just whatever you do, don't take a job that's not music related. And I pretty much stuck to that.
God, I was, I'm blessed with a good ear, good sense of timing, and a good memory. So I would play a song, and then I would know it. And so I would play, you know, Oh Susanna or whatever. And, well, you memorized that song. You have to read the notes. And over and over, you've memorized this. It's like, I played it once and I knew it. And so I failed. I got an F in music and got kicked out of the class because I wasn't able to read music because I was too good at memorizing it. So I continued to play music, but yeah, I had no encouraging words from my music teacher was the point I was trying to make.
It's funny. We had to memorize our marching band music, so that got my brain into memorizing, and I was a reader. Like I could, because when you're a trumpet player and you play in band 5 days a week, you can get really good at reading.
Yeah.
And when I came, and I ran into that a lot, people saying, oh, if you don't read, you're not, you know, a good musician or whatever. But then when I got to New England Conservatory, which is like one of the best music schools in the world, it was full circle because a lot of those jazz guys and teachers and students, they were the opposite, saying, if you don't have it memorized, you don't know it.
Yeah, if you can't, yeah. Well, you know, it's funny because it wasn't that long ago that I learned that, you know, I just figured if you could read music, you could play anything. And we had a friend who had been classically trained on the cello join a friend of mine's band, and she only knew how to read music. And she had never improvised. Improvising was an insane new skill for her. She had could not. She it was hard. And I thought, how could that be hard? You know all the notes, but you don't think of it that way.
So yes.
Yeah, I had a musician from the San Francisco Ballet tell me that. I said I was playing at a wedding, and he came up to me and said, "Great playing." I said, "Oh, you must be a musician." He said, "Yes." I said, "What do you do?" He said, "I play bassoon in the San Francisco Ballet." I said, "Oh, you're a real musician." He goes, "No, you're a real musician." But yeah.
Well, Vernon, how about you? When was the moment you decided you needed to be to play music? Was there a moment like that?
You know, I always wanted to be an NBA basketball player.
Uh-huh.
And I still play 2-3 days a week. And my knees speak to me about that. Maybe I should, you know, think about that maybe next week. But I had a scholarship. I finished high school in Billings, Montana. Uh-huh. Kansas City, Missouri boy, finishing up high school, Billings, Montana.
Uh-huh.
And Rocky Mountain College, they were checking me out. They wanted to give me a basketball scholarship, man. And my senior year in high school, I was already playing in the bands and the high school bands. Every weekend we would go out and play at local colleges. And
were you doing guitar at that point or a different instrument?
Oh, I was guitar mostly then, but you know, my first instrument was drums, then it was bass, and then it was guitar. And then I started singing a lot. Now it's backwards. It's like guitar and vocals are my mains. But, you know, I just ended up, man, that senior year in high school, I just decided, man, I think I'm feeling this music thing more. And my guys, we pitched our, we pulled our pennies like we were speaking about earlier, quarters, and we bought a 1958 school bus that needed work. And we turned it into a tour bus, and we drove that thing around in the northern, northwestern part of you know, where the colleges were.
Yeah.
And that was it, man. That was it. I'm done, and I'm here.
What genre of music was this? Was this big band or that kind of stuff, or were you playing rock and roll then, or blues?
Oh my
or?
God, what a great question. Too, for me, back then, although I was starting to love and embrace jazz, right then it was more of R&B and rock. I was rocking and hey, dude, the name of the band was Sweet Talk.
There you go.
But don't, you know, okay. But we were at that time in those late 70s. We were just rocking. You know, it was a rock band. And, and it was just great fun and great learning experiences and great lifelong friends forever, you know.
Yeah. Well, Rob, how about you? Have you always been jazz orchestra kind of, maybe an orchestra, big band kind of guy, or do you ever dip into the rock and roll scene?
Oh, it's funny. I've done so many different types of things, you know. When I was in school growing up, I played in the band, and did, of course, then you do classical and you do jazz, which... Uh-huh. was relatively new. I mean, they didn't have jazz in school until a couple decades before I started going to school, I think, maybe. But also, you know, I started playing in a band called Grooveyard when I was about 18 or 19.
One of those in every town.
And it was originals, but originals and covers. Uh-huh. And our drummer, Derek Phillips, he actually plays on the first Alpha Rhythm Kings record with us.
Uh-huh.
And he went on to play with, like, Charlie Hunter. And now he plays all kinds of famous guys. But... so we played the bars and stuff, and we did like R&B, funk, rock, and I've done everything. I was in a mariachi band for a couple years. They called me Weto. I was the only white boy, but it was great.
It's all right, as long as the check cashes.
I did it for 2 years. It was wonderful. And
cash only.
Like Chuck. Count that money before we play.
Eventually, though, about around maybe 2006 or so, because jazz became more and more my thing. That's what I studied in college.
Uh-huh.
And because of that, I joined this sort of jump blues swing band called Stompy Jones.
That band worked. He's still around, right?
Yeah. David Rose runs the band. Yeah, that band worked like, I think we played like 200 times a year or something.
I think they played here recently in town. It might have even been something silly like the farmer's market or something.
They might have. And that was the other time where I was so happy because I was like, I don't know, 30 or something. And I first went on the road with them and I just went. And that's when I quit teaching and just played music full time. And I just looked around and went, oh, this is my new normal. I like this. But David, the band leader, he was a real stickler to authenticity, right? Because I was like out of college trying to play like Clifford Brown, which I still wish I could. And, you know, all the jazz guys. And he was listening to old 40s rhythm and blues music where it's a different thing.
Right.
And I didn't know those records. And so he would like just drill it into us every day. And he'd say, you know, you couldn't. You didn't listen to Roy Milton to save your ass or something like that, you know? And I was like, you know? So after I played in that band for many years, I got to be, just by accident, an expert of like 1940s jump blues and swing. And then when I started my own band, I changed it up a bit, but I took a lot of that I got from Stompy Jones.
Yes, sir.
And that's why the band we don't just do the normal swing stuff. We do that like rhythm and blues, jump blues stuff too, which gives it a secret ingredient, I think, you know.
Now, describe jump blues? Is it kind of like almost a Brian Setzer vibe? What is jump blues?
There's all these different tentacles from jazz and blues, you know. Brian Setzer's is more, I would say, more rockabilly, maybe.
Yeah.
They crisscross. So the jump blues was basically rock and roll before they called it rock and roll.
Uh-huh.
And before the guitar took over.
It was a clarinet.
It was more, clarinet was earlier with the Dixieland and the big band. But jump blues, the big band shrunk down to smaller groups. And they kind of played with more of a driving rhythm. And the bass was very arpeggiated. Boom, 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 boom.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
They did a lot of shuffle. Instead of ding, 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 swing, they did.
Right.
So it was like a very different sound. Yeah. And it kind of turned Louis Jordan sort of, it was like before rock and roll, like the 40s. And once they started adding the guitar, it starts sounding like exactly like rock and roll. It's like the same thing.
So that was Louis Jordan that really pioneered that, huh?
He's a big pioneer.
In your mind, anyway?
But you know what's interesting, too, is even Boogie Woogie sounds like rock and roll. And they have Boogie Woogie recordings going back before the 40s. And I heard...
The 20s.
I heard that it was... The people were playing it in the 1800s, but I don't know. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Not everybody had a... An Edison, you know, phonograph there.
But it sounds like rock and roll when you hear it, you know.
Yeah, we're gonna jump away and take a quick break. We will be back with members of the Alpha Rhythm Kings momentarily, but it is now time, I'm not saying we have to have, we are privileged to have sponsors, because we are community radio here at 91.3 KSVY, and we are only, our only source of income is you, the community. We don't take big checks. Well, we don't. I mean, we, if somebody walked in with a big check, we'd be glad to take it. But we don't get big checks from NPR. We're not public radio or community radio. It's a whole different thing, as I'm sure you know. And we survive on donations and sponsor mentions. Even that, we have people that have signed up for every month. They give us $10. And they don't even, you know, that, you don't even notice that. That's a 1.5 lattes these days. But that $10 adds up to $120 a year for us, and that pays a bill. So something as little as that can help. Now, if you've got $10,000, or if you've had a really good year this year, and you're thinking, well, I got to donate some money to a nonprofit, a 501(c), well, we are one of those too. So keep us in mind, Dad, that it's tax time and the end of the year is coming up. And instead of donating to... I don't know. I don't want to disparage any other nonprofits. It's, you know, I mean, we're all worthy. But, you know, think about keeping KSVY in your donation pool. We're radio, for community radio, really is the last bastion of free speech in this world. You know, you don't, you know, you could choose your own playlist on Spotify, and that's all great. But here we have DJs that play what they want to play. Nobody's telling anybody what to do here. And as long as we're in, as long as we comply with the FCC rules, we get to still do that. So enough of me. We're going to hear from our sponsors now. And one thing I'd like to do is, if you are patronizing these sponsors and you go to their establishment and you say, hey, I heard your sponsor mention on KSVY, thank you for supporting community radio. And that goes a long way and lets them know that we have we know we have listeners, but it proves to other people, God, I had 9 people come in here and say they listen to the radio. I'm going to re-up my contribution. Now, if you personally just want to donate something, you can point your browser to ksvy.org. And there's a place there to just donate, where you can donate one time, donate once a month, or you can become a sponsor. And there's links there to how to become a sponsor and all of those wonderful things, and you can even volunteer. But in the meantime, that's enough about that. Here's a word from our sponsor. Well, thank you. Thank you, Jeff Gilbert, for that wonderful reintroduction. And like I said, we are here live in the studio with members of the Alpha Rhythm Kings, who you'll be able to catch their full act this Sunday. Sunday. Sunday at Music and Place on the Plaza. I believe this is the last show of the series. So if you haven't made it out to one of the shows on the Plaza that Music and Place is putting on, this will be your last opportunity until next year for the Plaza events. But I believe they're planning on putting on some other events. They're expanding their whole horizon of how they're doing shows. So now, how did you two hook up as band members? I imagine there's a story there.
Yeah, it's funny. I don't even remember how I first met you, Vernon, but when I started this band, like I mentioned, I was in that other band and at the
talent. Stompy?
Yes. And so Stompy wasn't working as much after a while, and so I was doing more freelancing. And then I thought, you know, why don't I just start a band too, so I have one more thing to book? You right. know, like if my band works once every 2 months, just it's another thing to do.
Right.
Wound up kind of taking over my whole life and becoming my main thing. But so I thought, well, what does a band need to do? I need to make a demo. And I said, well, this is my opportunity, because I've been playing with the same musicians, which were great. I was lucky. That band, Stompy Jones, had the same guys every gig. It was tight.
That's nice.
It was beautiful. But it was my chance to sort of say, if I were to pick whoever to make a great rec demo, who would I pick? And I had met Vernon a couple of times and we jammed or something, I don't remember, but so I called Vernon to be just, all the musicians had never seen the music before. That's what a lot of my fans would probably be shocked to hear. I don't think I've ever mentioned this before. Everyone on our first recording, it was supposed to just be a demo right. to like kind of book gigs.
Right.
It came out so great, I released it as an EP. And it has Hardy Hemphill on piano.
I played with him the other day at the Bohemian in the City.
Oh, okay. Yeah, so he played with, you know,
his list, tour with list all a kinds mile of famous long.
People. Yeah. And then I had Derek on drums. And I just made, like, what would I want for a great band? And so that's why I called Vernon, because I knew he had a great feel and all that. And so if there's anybody watching this online later, any that likes the band, you might not realize, because Vernon's not in our video for California Boogie and all that, because he was touring with Frankie Beverly, but he's on the recording, and you can hear, my music's very piano based, so sometimes the guitar gets a little left out, but he has a couple licks in there, and I told the mixing engineer, turn that up, and stuff like that, you know, like, so that's how we really worked. It was like, I want a great band for this recording, and then that's how we got it. And but Vernon has been on some other recordings that are a little bit more well known than the Alpha Rhythm Kings, like Mariah Carey, and maybe you want to talk about that too.
Yeah. Well, we'll get to that in a minute, because I do want to hear about that. But I want to hear a tune now that we've talked about a little bit.
Oh, sure.
This.
Yeah.
So you got a song that you can do for us?
Yeah. Do you want to do the blues, or do you want to do that?
Sure.
Yeah, let's do a blues. Let's do Outskirts of Town. Yeah.
Yeah. So this is Outskirts of Town. Now, is this a is this a traditional, or it's a American songbook, or is it original?
I don't remember offhand who wrote it, because we just off the cuff decided we can do it today. But I know it because of Louis Jordan,
right,
as a version of it. But I think so many artists have recorded it, and there's a lot of different variations on the words.
Uh-huh.
My words are based on Louis Jordan's version.
Got
so,
it.
Yeah.
Excellent.
Yeah, are we time limited on how long this song will be?
No, we got till 4:55. So
there
if you want to turn it into Freebird, that's fine.
Just
with
want to
me
make
too.
Sure, like, do we need to make it 1 minute or 10 minutes?
No,
minute?
Yeah, okay. Utah, this is your time.
Okay, cool.
What's along with a little pizza on our time?
If you keep going,
just kidding.
You can't tease it, or you
have,
you have to play it if you tease it. That's the whole thing.
Oh, no, we're going to play a jazz song.
So, should we start off with the 12 bars of guitar, maybe? Yeah.
We started getting in trouble at the same time.
That's good. Yes. Beatles, we can do whatever.
That's what we do here. Mm-hmm. All right, Alpha Rhythm Kings, or a portion thereof, here on 91.3 KSVY FM.
I'm gonna move way out on the outskirts of town. Gonna move way out on the outskirts of town. Cause I don't want nobody always hanging around. I'm gonna tell you, baby, we're gonna move away from here. I don't want no ice man. I'm gonna get me a Frigidaire when we move way out on the outskirts of town. Cause I don't want no money always hanging around. Gonna bring my own groceries, gonna bring them every day. That'll stop that grocery boy and keep him away when we move. Gotta watch that grocery boy.
Yeah.
Way out.
Yeah. And the milkman.
Skirts down. Cause I don't want nobody always hanging around. It may seem funny, honey, it may seem as funny as can be. But if we have any children, I want them all to look like me when we move. Woo-woo. Way, way out on the outskirts of town. Cause I don't want nobody always hanging around. Here's some guitar. Mm-hmm. Gonna bring my own groceries. Gonna bring them every day. Cause that'll stop that grocery boy and keep him away when we move way out on the outskirts of town. Cause I don't want nobody always hanging around. It may seem funny, honey, it may seem as funny as can be. But if we have any children, I want them all to look like me when we move way, 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 way out. Cause I don't want nobody always hanging around. You gotta watch out for the DoorDash. Yeah. The Amazon delivery.
Watch out, watch out. Put the camera on.
Yeah, the ring, fellas.
Thank you very much. The Alpha Rhythm Kings are members of them here in the studio live here on 91.3 KSVY FM Sonoma. You know, Vernon, tell me about that guitar. What exactly is that? Is that the Gibson something, right?
It's a Gibson something. Exactly. It's great that you noticed that. The something was made back in the days of the somethings when they were experimenting. Some people call it an L4.
Oh, really?
Yes.
I've seen L3s and L5s, but I don't know if I've ever seen an L4.
This is an L4 made in 1939. You see how that does?
Yeah, yeah. You barely make out the Gibson.
The word that says Gibson, it looks like I wrote it.
What year did you say that was?
1939.
Wow.
I shouldn't have said that. Now everybody's going to be like, they're going to be trying to break into my house.
No. You keep that.
That's what I think about, too.
Let me just let y'all know. Bad idea, bro.
Bad idea.
I ain't the one.
Yeah.
Now, what is that apparatus on the headstock there? Oh, is that tension for, you got big valence strings on there?
You know what? This is called a Van Epps mute.
Ah.
And this guy, last name Van Epps.
Yeah, I've heard the last name.
Created it because it's a big body guitar.
Yeah.
But when you plug it into an amp and you get it to a certain volume, and that certain volume doesn't have to be very loud at all, this big body starts just vibrating and resonating, and so it creates feedback. And so this guy said, well, just click this thing down, and it rests very gently and lovingly.
So it doesn't doesn't capo it up or anything. Just simmers things down. Keeps the strings from rigging.
Yes, basically that's exactly what it is. Yes.
Although I guess you couldn't use that first fret.
Unless you're playing in unless you got to play an E chord, then you're there.
Well, then
you just move it.
Yeah,
huh?
Yeah,
just
that's
move
cool.
It.
There you go. Now you got an E. Now you know.
It's an E chord.
Yeah, that's yeah.
Right. Other voicings. Yeah, voicings. Yeah. You guys know a lot more about guitars. I don't know anything about. I don't even know anything about trumpets. All the trumpet players want to talk shop, and I'm like, mine. I just play it.
Just play it.
It's really.
I learned a lot while playing, but it's just all about playing.
At the end of the day,
learning process.
Well, now Robin said you played with some. You know, when I met you, you said your name, and I thought. Vernon Black, God, that name sounds familiar. I probably read your name on somebody's album somewhere. You've played, who are some of the people you played and toured with? I mean, are you like more like a session guy, or were you for a while?
I started out a session guy.
Uh-huh.
And then, you know, meeting people and you know, playing in the clubs and stuff. I just met more people and... I won't go through the sessions. It's been a lot.
Yeah, I can imagine.
Narda Michael Walden was the producer for quite a bit of those sessions that got me started. And, you know, outside of the studio, that is. But, you know, I toured with Herbie Hancock for a couple years.
He's pretty good.
And I heard of him. Yeah, my friend, my sensei. And I played guitar and bass on that tour for a couple of years. Whitney Houston records. I am fortunate to get couple Grammys for that and blah, blah.
Oh, nice.
With Mariah, we mentioned. There's another Grammy for her, and I toured with her for about 12 years.
Wow.
Stevie Wonder, just a few spot dates within about 4 months or so, but I'm still proud of that. That's my dude.
Oh, man.
And many other, actually quite a few other of my heroes that I was fortunate enough to either record on their records or play live with them. But, enough about me. What about you?
Oh, nobody's here to hear about me. Now, this is an acoustic, but I imagine with that kind of tour, I mean, you've got electric. You play electric chops too, right? I mean,
I'm a rock guy.
What's your favorite axe for electric? What do you like, the Tele or Les Paul? Or?
Well, I designed a few of my own electrics.
Ah, okay.
My main one that's on most of the recordings that I recorded on. It's a Stratocaster shaped body, but I started just like that. I bought a body, Joel Tosta in Santa Cruz. God bless. We put this monster together. We call it a Frankenstein. And I had these ideas, and so did he and my wife. And we hung out, and we took breaks and had Haagen-Dazs vanilla ice cream and stuff, and continued to get creative. But that's my main guitar shape. The body shape is like a Strat, but the fretboard, the dimensions of the neck, a bunch of buttons and wiring and preamps and yada yada, et cetera, are on it.
Right.
Trying to keep it
short. Should hear him killing on the electric.
Maybe we'll check that out this week. We've got to take stuff away for a minute. We've got to hear a word from our sponsors. We will be back with more from members of the Alpha Rhythm Kings, who, once again, you can check out this Sunday at the Plaza as part of the Music in Place series. But in the meantime, we're going to just get right to our sponsors, and there's not going to be me pontificating here in the middle of it all. So we will be right back. And we are back with the Alpha Rhythm Kings, and they will be playing, in case you missed it, and if you're listening to the podcast, and I just said this, so it sounds like I'm just saying it right after again, but it was really several sponsor mentions ago. You can catch them this Sunday at the Plaza as part of the Music in Place series. But you guys have other gigs happening. What else do you got lined up?
Well, it's kind of crazy. I've been bringing the band back and forth, 2 days here, 3 days there, L.A., Vegas, all the stuff. We just signed a contract at Disneyland to be doing holiday shows there in December and end of November. But the
are you going to be there in January? Because I'm heading down for NAMM. My family's thinking of coming down for Disneyland.
NAMM's,
I'm thinking I'd catch that over there.
Right now it's not in my calendar, but they might book me something in January. So,
nice.
Yeah, hopefully.
I'll keep my ears open.
Yeah, so they have me for like November 26th and then like 4 or 5 dates in December. The last one's the 29th. But yeah, I'm really excited because we're playing at Yoshi's in Oakland on Wednesday the 23rd of this month, October. So
Like
in a couple weeks.
Two weeks from today.
And the reason I'm so excited is because that was always like a dream place for me to play when I was growing up in jazz. And I did achieve that dream where I played behind Lettucey. If you know Lettucey, she's a pretty famous artist.
Yeah.
And a couple different shows there in the trumpet section. And but this is the first time I'm there, like, with my own act, you know.
Right.
And they're going to put a little space for dancers because people like to swing dance to us. Because the song we just played for you was a slow blues, which we do that song. Uh-huh. But a lot of our songs are a little more jazzy.
Upbeat, lean forward, swing style.
And so they're going to put a space for dancing in there, which as far as I know, they don't do very often. A couple times they did it for salsa. But, you know, the room seats about, you know, 300 and something folks. And it's a Wednesday night, so I just want to encourage everybody to come support us on our debut at the, I think, the best jazz club on the West Coast, in my opinion.
Yeah, oh, it's definitely. Now, how do people get tickets, I guess, at Yoshi Box Office? Or can they find them on your website? At how do people find your, what do you have, you've got social and
all
that
stuff. Well, we do have
all
the social, everything's at Alpha Rhythm Kings. We have
Alpha Rhythm
Instagram.
Kings. Make sure you spell rhythm right.
Yeah, and
I spell
Alpha,
it wrong.
There's a lot of H's.
I spell rhythm wrong all the time.
I always tell people there's so many H's in Alpha Rhythm Kings. But if you go to alpharhythmkings.com, I think the first thing I have on the website, or at least on our calendar, is a link to the Yoshi show.
Okay.
And we're doing a promotional because we have these cool whiskey glasses we made that we made just for the band, and then we made a few more for some people we gave to. And I posted some really cool, you know, prop pictures of them a couple times, and everybody keeps hitting me up, when are you going to sell those? When are you going to sell those? And I haven't sold them yet, but we're giving, Yoshi's is going to give a couple away. So there's a cool, you can win free tickets and the Alpha Rhythm Kings engraved whiskey glasses if you enroll. They have a sweepstakes that only goes
at Yoshi's.
If you go to Yoshi's, you can find it or check our socials. Uh-huh. We have links, but it's only for another till October 13th. They're running the special to win the tickets.
Yeah, got it. Okay. Yeah. So is that the only local gig you got coming up, or you got other local things happening?
Yeah, I don't have a lot of local right now. The Sonoma this Sunday, the 13th, and Oakland on the 23rd.
Where did you play in Vegas when you were there?
There's a new amazing hotel resort there called the Fontainebleau.
I've heard of that.
Yeah.
I have some friends that were there, and so, they raved about it too.
Yeah, it's very cool. There's a lounge there called the Nowhere Lounge. I currently don't have anything in the calendar there, because I'm going to be doing a lot of, like I said, the Anaheim.
Yeah.
But I was there almost every month from January of this year for like these 4-day stints in the lounge there.
Nice.
And it's a very cool place. So if people want to see us in Vegas, they should check our calendar on alpharhythmkings.com because we might be, you know, back there at some point.
Yeah. Well, you know what? I want to hear another song before I talk my way right out of the hour. You got another tune for us?
Yeah, let's do something a little jazzier.
Okay.
How about My Blue Heaven?
Okay.
Now, is there a story behind this? Is this a traditional or Louis Jordan?
I do know the story on this one. We actually just played this. We were on Live in the Bay, which is like a TV.
Oh yeah,
I've seen that. The other day. We did an abbreviated version. They said it has to be 2 minutes.
Yeah, you don't. Well, yeah, we can.
We're getting close here.
Yeah,
we won't do too long.
We're community radio.
Yeah, but I do know because I'm actually, this could be a whole other conversation, but I joined the Friars Club, you know, the old famous New York Friars Club. I'm actually a friar, but when I was there, and there's a pool room, Frank Sinatra used to play pool in there, so I was hanging out in there taking selfies and stuff, and somebody said, this is where My Blue Heaven was written, and that's the song we're going to do.
Oh,
and so I looked it up, and according to Wikipedia, it was written during a game of pool by a guy named Walter Donaldson, a songwriter.
Uh-huh.
And I guess he was bored waiting and wrote the song at the Friars Club.
And they're playing it to this day. And
there you go. So
great.
Should we just turn on top with me singing?
Alpha Rhythm Kings live here on 91.3 KSVY-FM Sonoma.
When Whipple call and evening is nigh, I'm gonna hurry to my blue heaven. First you turn to the right, find a little bright light. It's gonna lead you to my blue heaven. You'll find a cozy place, a fireplace, a cozy room, a little nest that nestles where the road bloom, just Molly and me, and the baby make three. We'll be happy in my, so happy in my blue heaven. Mm-hmm. And evening is nigh. I'm gonna hurry to my blue heaven. Heaven, 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 heaven.
Hey.
First you turn to the right, you find a little bright light. It's gonna lead you to my, gonna lead you to my blue heaven. You'll find a cozy place, a fireplace, a cozy room, a little nest that nestles where the roses bloom. Just Molly and me, hello baby, make three. We'll be happy in my blue. So how about the business to get through the middle of the room? We'll be happy in my, so happy in my blue heaven. Buzzoo-bee-dup, womp, womp, yes.
That was fun. Man, you have cats really swing, man. You can swing with the best of them, man.
Man,
that's what I'm talking about right here. That's some swinging cats. There you go. Oh, my God. So we got a few minutes. We got 36 seconds left. Yeah. What's the future for the band? I mean, still gigging or just going to be recording or anything?
I'm still growing. I'm not giving up. We have a new song coming out, actually, in just like a few days, October 17th.
Uh-huh.
Our cover of Ragdoll by Aerosmith.
Oh, well, there you go.
Sort of Louis Prima vibe. And it's the best thing we ever recorded, I think, at Skywalker Sound. It's really good.
Oh, nice. That's
and we got a music
studio.
Video coming out for it, too. We're going to do a premiere on November 13th in Hollywood, actually.
And they can check all this out by going to alpharhythmkings.com is where all the info is.
And all the socials.
And they can grab you on the Spotify and all of that stuff. And the
Apple
where they give away music for free now and all that.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Well, hey, guys, thank you very much for being here. Alpha Rhythm Kings once again this Sunday in the plaza here in Sonoma. No charge as part of the Music and Play series. Break a leg this week, you guys, and
thanks,
we will
man.
Thank you, and thank you for making the trip up here. I have been your host, James Marshall Berry. You've been listening to 91.3 KSVY-FM Sonoma. Guys at 5 are next. Do stick around. We never know what those crazy cats are going to be up to. See you next time.